connect, whether that be your own performance or another artist's performance, but the making of the video, it turns that performance into something else. And video sort of becomes this third space where we're encountering someone's real performed presence in this mediated way that's very different than if we were watching Bilty Jones dance in a room or watching you perform in a gallery space. And I think it's interesting because now is, as its subtitle, a video ritual. And a ritual asks us to be really present and open to something, and yet the medium and the format, the installation format, creates something very dialogic. You have sort of a running commentary going on. On one side, as you're being invited to enter the circle and be present, on the other. So I guess that sort of segues us into talking more about now. And I guess I'd like to hear which of the kind of three starting points that you listed off, John, would you think describes sort of where you began with this piece? And maybe Monet, you started at zero.
There was a desire to go to places that we wouldn't go by ourselves, and I remember that part of the discussion about serious versus comic led us to the anxiety we're feeling. This was like a year ago, and although the times have not proved to be less turbulent than they were. At the time, it just looked like everything was going to shit. And we thought, what can we do? We feel powerless, we feel helpless. The stress and anxiety is overwhelming. As artists, you think, well, we're marginalized by so many different factors. Even if we, and this is after the Women's March and after great shows of power, it just seemed like the aspirations we had for society and civilization were just being flushed out of the toilet. And I can remember wanting to say, well, what can we do? What can we do? And this idea of focusing on now and the individual and the power of the individual, a lot of that came from Monet, but I identified with that mythic projection. Because a lot of the stuff that I've been doing recently involves reinterpreting different kinds of myths, Venus and Mars, Adam and Eve. And so somewhere in there, I think the idea was sort of born.
Yeah, I think that the time I spent being bedridden, there were protests happening, and I thought, I can't go. But I realized that we have amazing power within us that we contribute to a conscious whole from exactly where we're at. And the work we do on ourselves contributes to the greater picture. So the micro affects the macro and vice versa. So I wanted to give people a sense of that everything that we do is contributing and is part of, it's your activism. Whatever level you can engage, and to give people a sense that our attitudes and our beliefs are helping shape this ship, right? So if you're fatalistic and think there's no hope, then there really isn't, and vice versa. And if you, you know, think the opposite, then there is. So I didn't see it exactly as there is no hope, but you know, it looks hopeless.
I didn't say there's no hope, but it did feel shitty. feels marginally better now, but we'll see how things develop in Texas tonight.
So I was watching some comments that you recently made at Photo Fairs. Just sort of, you talked about the piece and sort of joked that the process of working together, you both kind of adopted aspects of these two warring characters. Could you speak to that a bit? And how did you arrive at a consensus if there was a lot of loggerheads along the way?
Right from the beginning when we decided, I've been doing ritual pieces a couple live ones, and I said, what about a ritual? And we had bounced some ideas off, and then yes, we were dealing with the world as it is, which are huge problems. And so two things happened in the beginning. One was I was thinking there would be one character as a guide, and John really, in that first meeting, said we have to have two characters. And I was a little hesitant at first, I don't know why, but I was, and then I realized that that was a brilliant way to have these different perspectives, and I'm really pleased that it came about. The other thing, on a second meeting, I recall John saying, I'm so glad we're going to make fun of this ritual stuff, we're not taking it seriously. My face just dropped. I actually really take this stuff seriously. I didn't have a sense of humor about it, but this is very real to me. So that set up a dichotomy, I think, that also, for me, works well in the piece. He said at one point, he said, I want you to write down ritual. What are we going to do? What is this ritual going to be? How do you do it? And I was like, okay, well, I have to think about what tools am I going to use. So he said, I just want you to convince me, Monet, when you write the script. Well, you to convince me that this stuff is real?
Because the skepticism has a value, and as we see, yeah. but as with like the amazing Randy, I want to believe, or I think that's X-Files. I want to believe.
So I think that these basic beginning conversations set up a structure to work within that. I went to, back to texts and scientific research and things where I could prove, what I'm talking about to some degree with the character Perspicacious. And I think that was really fun to bring that to the audience. People more of John's mind to have an entry point.
Well, it also reaffirms in a wonderful way the faith that the two characters have, because they both have a very strong faith, and they will unify in their own particular manner. But without that faith, they're just going to fight. But because they have the faith, and they're representing this delightful yin-yang duality, when they do finally come together, I think we recognize in ourselves, or hopefully you guys recognize yourself, oh yeah, I got a little bit of this, I got a little bit of this, or a lot of this, and a lot of, whatever the... So I ended up being the Scully character, the skeptic.
But I relate to her as well.
Of course, and I relate to the Mulder character as well, because I desperately want to find here and here the things that are going to get us out of this awful mess.
Well, I think art requires a certain leap of faith as well. I mean, you think about the basic tenet of,
which
conceptual art,
really
right?
Mean,
like,
right?
Yeah, like the art happens after you leave the gallery with the prompt and enact it. I mean, you think about Yoko Ono's Grapefruit, right? And her series of instructions. And in some ways, that's what you're asking of us with this piece. Insofar as there is a ritual behind it. It's
there's a leave behind.
Yeah.
And the leave behind is to breathe, to recognize your power. This is the phrase that I keep repeating because it's so perfect. Is you matter now. And if you really, and for me, I had to put my arms around that and really hug it close. But it's beautiful Because we forget about it. We think we're just adrift. We think we're awash. We think there's no hope.
That was another fundamental lesson that I got from being bedridden. And my illness, the severe portion of it, which I'm still ill, but was 12 years. So it was really intense experience that I went through. And so yeah, there's these kernels that kind of floated up to my consciousness that I carry with me from that time. And one of them is that you matter now. That again, my bedridden self was contributing to the world in a very powerful way. And by healing my own history, you know, I'm healing back up through my ancestors and forward in time to whoever comes ahead of me. And I used to say certain things like, I it's Buddhist, you know, kind of framework, but I dedicate my practice today of getting through another day and staying alive to those who I will influence later, come after me. So those are the little kind of seed kernels that are in now.
I brought with me, when we sat in my studio and we were like just spritzing, my way of dealing with spectacle and multi-screen storytelling is to think spatially. A curator who has been very good to me over the years, John Hanhart, who was at the Whitney and then the Guggenheim and the Smithsonian, reminded me when I came out of Silicon Valley and started making video art again, that time was really important, but space was important. So I ended up sketching a lot of stuff that we talked about and spatially kind of arranging. So there's a lot of the conversation that I wrote down. I don't know if you want to pass this around, but it pretty much looks like what we ended up making.
We came up with it very quickly from the beginning. Yeah. We stuck to it. We changed. We were going to have the two characters hanging on a scrim, and we came to the gallery and realized the walls were movable.
Yeah.
So that we could play with that. But it wasn't, it came very quickly how we were going to structure things, but the process of building it and working together from very different perspectives and methods didn't come easy. It was really, really hard, actually.
But Catharsis was originally going to be way over there, and Perspicacious was going to be way over there. And because we had an earlier sketch and an earlier concept.
I don't remember that.
But what's that?
I don't remember that. I thought they were going to be above.
They were, and then at one point we said, let's put them at the far end, let's have them almost like shouting at each other. But the intimacy of, so the columns were a blessing, because the intimacy of being able to draw everything in here, it means you can't stand in one place and see everything. You have to kind of go in the circle. And maybe the ideal room for the piece in the future would be a circular room with one entrance, where you'd have to stand inside. And this is me, the non-ritual guy, but I feel really good when I go. And we mocked it up in my studio, kind of very crudely, but it was really wonderful when you were sort of really surrounded by all these elements. And the large screen is the projection of what they're thinking, what they're feeling. It starts with diatribe and becomes much more of an emotional canvas for the two characters, which is why they end up on that screen at the very end.
And that evolved. I had originally envisioned her casting the sacred circle from the big screen. That was my vision all along. And so we really battled over that one. And I said, I learned in collaboration, you have to ask, why do you want this? So I could understand what's. And there was in the opening scene, there's very rawly put found footage, which I had chosen the movements of our day that I think are important, like Standing Rock. To me, it's extremely important. It's a line drawn in the sand because we cannot go any further with oil. We're destroying our own home that we live in. And he put them, and I was going to have them, I had thought they would be superimposed inside Perspicacious Silhouette on the right side, and she would be up on the big screen casting the circle from this grand, you know, the landscape, and he changed it all, and I said, why? And he said, this was like my favorite part of the whole collaboration, was he said, well, you know, I'm starting to realize that this ritual shit is real, and I want, you know, people, when she's talking about the Global Consciousness Project, how each of us contribute to this greater kind of energetic, you know, noosphere, they call it, that we all live within, that influences, comes back and influences. I want them to see the found footage and connect, like, that is the world she's talking about, and make it real and concrete and not ethereal, and so that, and I was like, okay, I got it.
It's that, no longer a clip on YouTube.
That makes sense to me. I still wanted, you know, we still did some compromising and some things, and then I said, he said, I'm starting to feel this stuff is real, and I said, that's the whole point of the piece, you know? And then we high-fived. That was the only time we high-fived.
No, that's you came in one day and you said, oh, act one, scene two is perfect. And at that point, I think we were really having a wonderful handshake about what we thought the intentions.
The blending of our two styles finally were just perfect.
Yeah, it was a good, nice hug. And then yes, my need to find more yin and to actually settle some things down. I needed to hear that. We needed to talk about that. That was really, really good. Good for me and good for the piece.
So I wonder, like, what do you feel like, having done this, do you sort of foresee this experience shaping how you approach your future work, not just in terms of collaboration, but, you know, what are you taking from this process?
Well, I'm finishing a piece right now that I'm going to show in Paris starting on March 12th, which is a retelling of the story of Adam and Eve, and I was already looking to say, all right, yes, I'm resigning from the patriarchy, but this helped to deepen things that I needed and wanted to feel about the feminine, and also about this idea of not being isolated. Not feeling isolated, but being connected, and how to actually kind of make that connection possible. And then in April, I'm going to do a live performance work about the future, a sci-fi piece, with a dozen French artists. And I know that a lot of the concept came from what I learned from working with Monet on this project. In fact, my major collaborator is a guy, an incredible artist named Pascal Lièvre. And one of the things that we're connecting on is about how to kind of look at a non-patriarchal future. But to do it what I do feel is kept us very connected was the idea that the humor, surprise, and drama of the script that Monet wrote that we were actually kind of bringing to life on the screens was going to be surprising for people. And it's great when people come in, it's 24 minutes and 6 seconds, and they come in the middle of it and they watch it all the way through and then they watch it again. And you think, okay, it's not traditional theater, it's not television, it's not performance, it's some weird hybrid, but we got it. We're speaking to them. And if they go out taking just a little bit of a deeper
writing a lot about the piece and reading about ecofeminists in the late 90s, which is when I was ill, which I guess crashed and burned in my mind because of sexism. It still lives on, of course, but it, you know, as a particular genre of feminism within critical discourse and academia, it got kind of axed because they stereotyped the women involved. So, but I was reading, and it was like everything I had written was what they were saying, this intersectionality between sexism, racism, colonialism, capitalism, speciesism goes on and on, ecology. And to me, there's a fundamental deficit culturally in feminine principles. So again, to go back to the mystical Taoism, the opposite of the way our world is that the yin is, it's cooling, for one thing. And if you look at things in holistic theory, when pieces are out of line, things start to become imbalanced. If we're imbalanced, we exploit too much. We don't nurture, nurtures yin, exploit is yang. Yang conquers, yin protects. Yin is stillness, yang is movement. Yin is non-linear thinking, prophecy. We reference the black snake prophecy in here with the snake, which is 1,000 years ago. Sioux medicine men predicted the destruction of oil as a snake. It's the oil lines, right? Intuition as opposed to linear thinking, logic. So it's not that either one is more important than the other, it's just that we culturally value one over the other. It's not that they're indicative to, this is what killed ecofeminism, is they're saying, oh, you're saying all these things are what women are like. They're essentialists. They're all saying, all women are nurturing. That's all that. We want to be nurturing. It's like, no, that's not what they were saying, and that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that we all have these roles, that these abilities within us, and we don't value. It doesn't matter what sex you are and how you're doing these roles. What matters is we devalue them culturally. Indigenous peoples, not always, but all the ones I've ever looked at, all the cultures I've ever looked at, value the feminine principles equally to the masculine. They have a medicine man that does these deep layers into their consciousness and non-linear thought. And that's a value part of their culture, as well as a warrior, or a hunter, or whatever. So this is just gaining steam. My next piece is, I already had started writing before now. This actually derailed those, but it, enriched my concepts. But their projection, so it was really great to do this and project, because that's new for me. And they are multi-screen, so it was awesome to work with a master multi-screen installations to kind of bring some of that back into this next piece I'm going to do. It's going to be 5 projections, larger than life, where I play different characters that are dismissed, again, culturally, feminine characters, a healer, which will be like a shamanic character, but they'll be dressed, they'll be kind of like my, I didn't show you, I work in 2011, which is called the Lookbook Series, which is visually looks like the fashion world, so I'll be back to a fashion model-y kind of look, but they're going to be, one of them's an oracle, and I'm going to make about 25 different versions, so the audience will come through and see them at different times, and they'll get different messages, so it is like a divination, in particular healing, and there's going to be a mother character who's breastfeeding, which is another thing. Critical theory doesn't want to talk about mothering. Feminists don't want to talk about mothering. It's like, it's insane to me. Sure. And they're all going to be in a half lotus position. So I'm branching out into multi-screen pieces. And then I'm also making, and that's called Volva Saga. V-O-L-V-A are Norse, traditionally women that were very powerful, were healers and mediators. They carried a staff, and they also existed in Iceland. And I got into these Valkyrie stories through Making Now, and this is part of the Valkyrie iconography. And these are the images, these are the performances for still camera that I did before I made Bunny Girl. This is what led to Bunny Girl. Okay. That was my friend's outhouse.
Now that's funny. That's funny.
Juxtapositions of my life. And then I have a single channel piece that I'm working on that's going to be Volva Saga 3. I kind of almost look at now as Volva Saga 1, but I'm going to call the other two Volva Saga 2 and Volva Saga 3.
Talk a little bit about the fact that you actually are a practitioner as well. And I watched many people, this is at the Crows Were Killing, I watched many people come in and be really magnetically attracted to your practice.
I work as a psychic. My cards say intuitive because the word psychic is such a charged word. I don't even like to tell people. I just kind of, clients come to me through word of mouth. I work on the energetic level of the body, and I can close my eyes and see many, many things that go through the chakras. Each chakra relates to different parts of your physical life. And the first chakra is survival, the second is emotions, and for women, sexuality, and the third is your will, your willpower, and the fourth is your heart, and so on. And I read for people. I do not predict the future. So a lot of people think that's what psychics do. I get people in the present time. So out of traumas of the past, different ways to reflect on those things, I give them exercises to continue the healing after they leave me. Sometimes that's actually nutritional. I've studied nutritional medicine very, very in depth to get myself well from my illness. I can show them tendencies and potentials for the future, but it's my belief that the future is activated in every moment of the present. So it's very much about how we create our future. We're all handed a certain life that we're given, and certain parents and ancestry and histories, and some people have genocide in their histories, and I can see it, the impact of these things. Sometimes there's healing to be done back in the line, but it's always to get people in present time so they're the most potent form of themselves, balanced, healed form of themselves to carry on their mission, so to speak. So that particular performance, I took a feminist text. It's called The Intuitive Feminist, and it's about this idea how we hate on these feminine principles, like intuition. I was telling Matt, if you're walking down the street and you feel somebody's kind of behind you and you get the creeps and you turn around and there is some weirdo, that's your intuition. You know, the military studied intuition with pilots in World War II because they'd have a hunch that the enemy was on their tail, and they always were. And they, so, you know, military studied everything, right, that like could possibly be useful to them. So, you know, these are just culturally, we've suppressed this, goes back to the burning times. I really wanted fire in this type of burning times. Anyway, so this was feminist text that I did bibliomancy. I had people come in, and I would say, I usually have people hold a goal in their minds, and this was specifically going to be related to balancing their masculine and feminine, their yin and yang. And then I would open to a page in feminist text, so I'd go back to critical theory, and then I would read something, and then I would elaborate on it for them, and then I gave them a flower essence, like I do now, that was to balance their masculine and feminine. And it was really interesting, because it was Crows Were Gallery, so there's a certain type of man that walks through that door usually, but they were all, had so much hesitance to be masculine, or to enact the masculine principles, the yang, and that's equally as important. So there was a lot of wounded, you know, just thinking like all yang, you know, attributes are terrible. Being masculine is terrible, you know. And so that was really interesting. Every single man that sat for me that night had the same issue. That was really interesting. Yeah, and I just cast a circle before I started to kind of do a protection thing. But I do a lot of clearing of the energy afterwards, so I'm already protected. There's just, and there's a way to run my energy while I'm working that keeps me safe. So. So weird to talk about this in an art setting.
You've created like an avenue for it in an art setting.
I know.
Maybe it's only the, you know.
I still feel stigmatized.
Well, but that's kind of what's fun.
Yeah.
Also, I think what's what's amusing is the idea that stuff doesn't necessarily have to be in one particular phylum. When I was making video in the 70s, 80s, and even the 90s, I was making work for television, museums, music videos, commercials, TV shows, so unclassifiable. I didn't necessarily have a pristine art career, and I was fine with that. You had hesitancy about talking about Bunny Girl as a movie. It's a movie! And film festivals want to show it. Fuck it. If they have to call it a movie, call it a movie.
I don't think that's a statement, though. I just didn't know what to call it.
But it's, yeah, it's one of those things where if you're doing something and somebody needs to put you in a particular place, there's something wrong going on. What's wonderful about Heather and Camera Works with our project, and I'm sure with a lot of other things, is she didn't really care. She was like, do something different, do something that matters, do something energetic, do something. And she raised the money and she supported us, and she didn't care what you were necessarily, what you call it. So performance, installation, ritual, participatory, doesn't matter. Anyway.
Well, I think the challenge for all of us moving forward tonight, and I hope you do return to spend more time with the piece because it does merit repeated viewings and close attention. You kind of attune to your own wavelength within it, even though there's a lot of information coming at you. You know, I think that it's not about, you know, classification, as you were saying, but sort of what does one find when one is truly present with oneself.
And we're asking you to do that. And I,
yes,
for when we decided that that was going to be the focus, I was overjoyed that the fact that there'd be a takeaway, that there'd be an experience, and people could come and actually go, all right, I can bring this home with me. There's part of this that I can bring home with me.
You know, there's a lot of irony in the piece. It's like we're telling you to be present, and then we're bombarding you with lots of visual stimulation at the same time, and to read. And so, you know, it's just kind of a portrait of life, you know. That's what life is like. We're bombarded with things all the time. So I just hope to impart some tools through the piece, but also to bring up these issues. Really concerning to me how feminist discourse, to me, suppresses the feminine principle. So I think on a critical theory level, that's really my message.
Well, thank you.
Questions?
And thank you, John.
Any questions?
Any questions? A question that I've been waiting 3 weeks to ask, which is, could you comment on the fact that you've set up an immersive environment, but that also works on Persimmon level? And that if you watch it from the couch, there's a fourth wall, and that's sort of my favorite because I can watch both characters. But what I'm even more intrigued by is the tension between them.
Well, there's formal aspects to the piece that until we actually put it up, we couldn't really experience. So we could conceptualize certain things. The tension between the two characters was written in, was designed in, was, as we worked on it, the mock-up environment was really predicated on how the mind and the experience was going to bounce between the different screens. There's also time mix, and the challenge in doing something that has some kind of story in a time base where it's relatively unpredictable. You don't sit down, popcorn, the lights don't go down. You could wander in. So you have to ask, well, what's the 5-minute experience? What's the 10-minute experience? What's the 20-minute experience? Can someone be satisfied with a slice, or do they have to eat the whole pie? And those are really good questions. I don't know if we have definitive answers, but there's certainly things going on when you stand inside the space that you don't feel when you're outside the space. The physical, the fact that you have to actually occupy the space as the characters are having their conversation, I feel is something that I would love to either ratchet up or explore further, because there's a dynamic there that just demands you not sit back passively, you have some level of aggressive interaction. And the engagement, the Velcro, is a really curious thing, because the Velcro is actually the power she has to perform, the manufacturing of the performance in the environment, and then this idea that you're gonna step inside and really say, all right, I'm gonna cross this line. I'm not gonna watch it like I do Netflix. Oh, you could binge this, no question. Does that make sense? Does that answer your?
Almost, yeah.
I have a question. You see my piece, Cross Voyeurism, right?
What now?
Cross Voyeurism.
Oh, yeah.
Does that break down the fourth wall to
you? It reverses the fourth wall. Makes you into the fourth wall.
Oh, right. But that, this does that too. So Cross Voyeurism was a piece I did in 93 or 4 or something. Where I am.
Fourth wall of come.
Yeah.
It's the fifth wall.
So Walgreens calling saying my prescription's ready.
The other wall.
Where I did a striptease for a private collector for a large sum of money. And I said that I used to work as an exotic dancer, a stripper, whatever. At the time, in the late 80s, like everybody did, I don't know, so common. Paid for grad school and everything. Or early 90s, late 80s, early 90s. Anyway, I agreed to take this job with the agreement that I could bring my camera and put it on a tripod and shoot footage of the person with his camera shooting the footage and voyeuring me. And so we set it up and he was really confused because he's like, I thought you were gonna put your camera over here and shoot your performance. I'm like, no, I'm gonna shoot you. He's like, oh, it's all on camera too, you know, and he's saying, well, as long as I shoot you first, and then he laughed or something. I don't know. I can't remember what his joke was, but anyway. So when I made the piece into a single channel video, I wanted to include the audience who's watching the piece as part of a voyeuristic triangle, so that they are voyeuring him, voyeuring me, but they're also, you know, participant in this kind of dastardly, you know, act. And so it says that, it sets it up in the piece. So this idea of the audience as part of the piece is something that I've been interested in forever. And with this piece, I was really excited. We both talked about this at the beginning, of having the characters talk directly to the audience. That to me was really exciting, to actually address audience members. So the audience is like, oh, I can't just hide. You know, I actually have to, like, I'm here. Yeah, you're talking to me. You know, oh, I gotta breathe. You know, or what am I thinking right now? You know, to just get that awareness.
About the t-shirt in a way are the things that you're hoping that they say about the whole
saying, I kept stressing the healing and the idea of transformation, and Monet kept saying, well, we can't guarantee that. It's not necessarily a given. So, yes.
This might make someone angry.
Yeah, so the takeaways ended up being something that we still wanted to have, but yeah, the tincture is really great.
Well, it's about process as opposed to end result, which again is pretty masculine, feminine stuff. I'm hoping to people have a process be engaged by experiencing the piece, and where that leads them is ultimately up to them. But just quickly, natural medicine and nature are also feminine principle, of course, and I think it's really strange that we don't have it easily alongside of Western medicine, because they both offer very different things. And so that's another, to me, a form of political activism, is to give out natural medicine with the piece. It's very calculated, like why I made the choices. And then the flowers were intuitive. I didn't consciously say I want this and this and this one. I just tuned into them. And then when I read what they were for, they were perfect for what was going on in the ritual. And so you'll all get a bottle if you haven't already. And the healing property for each one is on the bottle. So you can read more what it's doing for you. And then finally, it's vibrational. It's actually not a tincture. Tincture is more physical medicine. It's vibrational, where you imprint each element, or each plant, everything in the whole world has a vibrational signature, and it's imprinted in water. And this is ancient practice. I've done this forever. And then it's preserved with a little bit of brandy. So it's post-Newtonian physics, which is another, to me, point of the piece to kind of push that into our collective thinking.
So, yes.
Level, there is no space and time, and intention is 99% of the law. So basically, whatever you set up at any given point can go back in time, can go forward in time. So when you do a ritual on camera with the intention that it provokes some kind of result in people whenever they watch it, it's set up energetically to do that. And that takes us out of linear thinking, which is Jung, the master, I keep saying these things, to post-Newtonian physics, which is intention-based. So for me, it makes perfect sense, and it's really exciting to do that, to play with technology in that way. And I'm really interested in how technology and ancient, you know, indigenous practices can combine, and how powerful that is. And just like I'm in combining Western medicine and pharmaceutical nature. right? You do rituals in nature, you're activating. But we went into nature, which was really fun to get him out of a studio and take him on cliffs and freak him out. Noises, cars going by.
Challenges, we call them challenges.
But I think that it's the idea that we can be transported through a screen. We're disembodied, right, through the screen, but then we're trying to be embodied. I mean, that's a hindrance.
There was also, in a way, there was a gag there. The idea of a video art ritual seemed like an oxymoron, right? It seemed like we're mixing oil and water, but in a kind of a clumsy way. But the intention was, all right, we're going to take the technology and we're going to speak to things the technology doesn't usually speak to. And pull that off, hopefully driven by these two characters and by this kind of somewhat epic presentation. So we talked actually a lot about the piece I was going to show, because Dale was interested in this idea of movement and third and fourth walls. I did a project in France. Nine walls of a chapel, and so you couldn't stand in one place and see the whole work. You had to actually move through the space. But what ended up happening is it had wonderful music by a composer named Teresa Wong, and people started dancing because it was very dance-oriented, and so they were very motivated to go from one part of the place to another. And that was very much an echo of what television does. Television instructs. Television informs, television surrounds. A lot of intentions aren't correct, but when you walk away with a cultural shroud. And when you decide to use that in a positive way, if you're making a dance that's trying to kind of transcend sort of basic prose and become something that's more poetry, technology can be very, very powerful. And the repetition and the circularity, another thing that I really enjoyed that we kind of got to together was the circular nature of the work. It's an endless loop. And that alone was just a tremendously fun thing. So it does have a cadence, a narrative cadence, but it really never stops. When the singers are finished, the clouds that surround them suddenly part to reveal this goddess on a hillside in Malibu. And it's like, that's pretty trippy.
Clouds for John's idea.
Well, what I wanted was we had a lot of this black and white, positive, negative. The palette was something that was inherent in the ritual, but also was something that we wanted to expand. The splashes of blood and red are very, very dramatic. And I thought at one point, what about white on white? And I thought this could be a very sort of cleansing moment. And so the clouds and the snippets of the songs just sort of lent themselves to this reveal of, all right, we're going to go back and we're going to perform a ritual together. Other questions?
Any questions? That might be a nice note to end this gathering on. Yes. Thank you for going back into your archives and just being so generous and present, sharing with us how this came into being. Before we commence to mingling, I wanted to just put in a quick plug. BAVAC is accepting applications for the next round of the Preservation Access Program. That means that we can offer our services at a subsidized rate, thanks to the NEA. So if you or if you know someone who has a magnetic media archive...
Videotape to all you guys.
Okay. Yes, videotape or audiotape. If it's in any sort of magnetic media format, please consider applying, because it's a great way to ensure that your work can be seen by future generations.
Yeah, and it's you'll see shit you've never seen for years because you've been watching VHS or 3/4 inch, and you get a digital copy of the 1 inch, and you're like, my God, that's the color that I, yeah, that's what it's, yeah. It's cool. It's very cool.
Thank you, Mrs. Kenmore.
Thank you.